Hello, welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm Mike Zielinski. My guest today is Angela Faust Izzo, who is a accomplished painter from Boyertown, a painter with a marvelous sense of humor. She has been described as someone who paints ordinary things in an extraordinary way with a marvelous sense of humor, which I think is an intoxicating combination. You are a realistic painter, realism, which is basically you're drawing with like a precision photography or whatever. It looks like a fantastic picture, right?
Yeah.
Is that harder?
I don't know. It's just what I like to do. I think I'm a little bit of a perfectionist, so I just like to make things look real. But
because I always marvel, how do people do that? How do you, you know, get it so accurately, especially faces?
I think you have to be a little off. It takes time, but it's just all about accomplishing it.
Yeah.
Recreating.
We're blessed. We're going to be showing in a little bit a lot of your paintings. Your story is very interesting, I think. You went to Kutztown University, and you got out of school, and you got married.
Yes.
And then suddenly you had four children.
Yeah.
And
like
tell us about your line about, like, if you have a boy and a girl, you're what?
Yeah, I was always told if you have a boy and a girl, that's like the doctor's family. It's a rich man's family.
Yeah.
But I had two boys and two girls, so it's definitely the poor man's family.
But the thing is, though, having all those children, which mm-hmm. obviously have been great subject material with your husband, Chris,
yeah.
for your paintings.
Yeah.
You needed to supplement your income because kids are expensive.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
So you started a very small way becoming a freelance artist, correct?
Yes, yeah.
And it kind of like blossomed.
Yes, yeah, so far. It's still blossoming.
But the whole key was to find the time. And now you basically devote at least one day where you paint, right?
Yes, sometimes more.
How many artists bring a sense of humor to the work like you do?
I think that humor is a part of a lot of artists' material, but I certainly am more interested in the comedy aspect of it. I feel like I love comedy. I think it's fascinating that a stand-up comic can stand in front of like 100 people
yeah.
and captivate them for, you know, an hour and not have anything flashing in front of them, just telling stories. And so I like to use my paintings as a way to tell stories that are funny, but I think that humor kind of, it helps people be more accepting of what you're trying to say. It's less threatening.
Yeah, because, you know, you think of art, and from a layman's perspective,
yeah.
you go to a museum, and it's kind of like hoity-toity. And
right. Why so serious?
So you're kind of like a breath of fresh air.
Oh. Now,
so you go to different galleries, and you have exhibits and exhibitions, or how's that work?
Yeah, right now I'm showing locally. I work with Studio B in Boyertown. That's my local gallery. I show a lot there. I volunteer there, and then I've been showing at the Goggle Works, and if I'm finding time to do more, I want to get out beyond our county, but
yeah.
I'm still working on that.
And so you're making money doing this as well, right?
Yeah, I am. I'm selling paintings and prints and teaching. You know, that helps.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure. Now, the people who buy your paintings, a lot of them people with families, young families, they can relate to this, or
I think some of my work, the print work, gets sold a lot, and I think that women in particular can relate to that. And there are a couple pieces that I have that, you know, ladies will walk by and they're like, yes, and they like, yeah.
Now, the thing is, just having read about you and meeting you just a few minutes ago, you are so much fun. But you were thrown, life unfortunately sometimes throws wrecking balls at
sure.
us.
Yeah.
And after you gave birth to your last child in 2011, you developed a life-threatening illness which led to a lot of complications, and you weren't always so happy. Tell us a little bit about that.
Because
you want to share this.
Yes, yeah. That's an important part of my story. I think that a lot of what I do now comes out of that experience. And in 2011, when I was pregnant with my last child, I developed unknowingly severe preeclampsia. and was basically walking around with it for the last couple weeks of my pregnancy, not knowing, because the symptoms just were not presenting in the typical way that they would.
And which are?
Usually you have very high blood pressure. Yeah. I had some weird things going on where I lose sight in one eye, but because I was clinically healthy everywhere else, they weren't very concerned. But had they done like a blood test or something, you know, done some testing, they would have seen that I was developing preeclampsia. And so after I delivered my son, it escalated further to a condition called HELP syndrome, and it's an acronym for something very serious that I can't remember at the moment, but it basically my liver and kidneys were shutting down.
Whoa.
Yeah, so, you know, I bled profusely. It was very traumatic because I remember looking at my doctor and her eyes were as big as saucers and I didn't understand what was going on.
And this was before you gave birth?
This was after. They took the baby, they wheeled me into recovery, and then, you know, I started to hear the nurses say things like, well, she can shower, but she needs to do it quick so she doesn't have a seizure. And, you know, I'm like, whoa, what's going on here? And, you know, then they wheeled me back to labor and delivery, and things started to progress and I was bleeding and it wouldn't stop. So there was this moment where I was like, oh my God. And
because you're worried about the baby too.
Exactly. I mean, I didn't know what was going on. I wasn't sure what was happening with me. I didn't realize at the time it was life-threatening.
Was it life-threatening to your baby?
It can be. Usually babies that are born with a mother who has preeclampsia, they can have some negative effects as well. But fortunately, he was healthy. And they told me that it was very fortunate that he was born when he was, because he was 10 days early, and it was almost as if my body was saying, okay, there's something wrong here and you need to give birth, because when you have HELP syndrome, it's basically like your body is not accepting the placenta inside your body, and that's why it starts to shut down, starts to attack itself.
Yeah.
So, after that happened, I was in the hospital for 3 days, and they put you on magnesium sulfate, which is to keep you calm so you don't have a seizure. So I was very out of it. And, you know, I just remember, you know, not being able to see him.
Meanwhile, your husband's dealing with the newborn and three other kids.
Yeah, other kids. You know, he had no idea this was happening. He had gone back to the house to go get our kids to bring them to meet their new baby brother. And when he got into the labor and delivery room, here I am, you know, really sick, and you know, you see the hustle and bustle of the doctors and the nurses, and he knew something was going on. So it was really traumatic for him and for the children who were young at the time. But I remember my daughter, who I think she was like 6 at the time, was just like, she knew something was going on. So for all of us, it was really upsetting.
Oh.
Yeah.
So how long were you in dire straits that way?
Let me out of the hospital after 3 days because I was really depressed because I wasn't able to see my baby, you know, do the normal things that a new mother would do, like nurse your baby or whatever.
Yeah.
And so they allowed me to go home, but I had to monitor my blood pressure like every hour because, you know, high blood pressure could be a problem. That's a complication you can get from preeclampsia or eclampsia. And so I spent a couple days just really tired and worn out because I had to have a blood transfusion. So there was just a lot of stuff going on.
And you're not sleeping well with the newborn?
Right. And then thankfully my husband, who's just wonderful, he stepped in and helped a lot with him and was able to bond with the baby, who I felt really bad after a while because I wasn't really involved with him in the beginning, so I felt like he didn't like me. And he liked his dad a little more.
Yeah.
So there were a lot of things going on, and that kind of snowballed into a depression that kind of lingered over me for 2 years.
2 years?
Yeah.
And so not a lot of laughs then at all. You were really kind of depressed. And you had to take some medication, a lot of medication, because your brain chemicals got out of whack?
Oh, yeah. I was, you know, this can happen. I mean, when you have a baby, you can have postpartum depression. And my doctor thought I probably had post-traumatic stress after the incident. And I remember driving in the car, and I heard
scared.
Voices say, you know, you open the door and jump out. Like, and that, at that point, I said to Chris, okay, something's off, and he was like, we need to go to the doctor. And so they put me on medication to help me get back to where I needed to go.
And so it was basically just triggered by this illness, and once you got beyond, the medications got you back in balance, you were your old self?
Well, I went through a lot of counseling, too. I think that's really important when you're, you know, suffering with depression. And my nature is, I can be a very depressed person, and
really?
I suffer from anxiety, yeah. And Yeah, apparently we find that out about people who act like they're funny on the outside, right? You know?
I did not know that. Yeah.
So I have an anxiety disorder, and I suffer from depression. So the counseling really helped to get me into a place where I could get off the medication and be more balanced.
Now, how did your painting, how did your artwork, what role did that play in it? Because actually, this all led to a continued burst of creativity, yeah. Right? Tell us about that.
Yeah. Well, a friend of mine had a farm and has a farm, and they asked me to paint a farm sign, and all of this stuff happened kind of as I was trying to paint this sign, right? And I got sick, and 2 years went by, and I never finished the sign. And one day I was like, you know what? I'm going to pick up the paintbrushes, and I'm going to start painting again. And I did, and I finished it. And it was just like, it was just a farm sign, you know? It was a picture of a farmhouse in a field. But just painting again, it was like there was like a little bit of happiness that I forgot. And I remember growing up, like, I always was painting, always drawing. And my mom...
And that gave you happiness.
It did. Yeah. And my mom used to say to me, have you painted today? When I was, like, kind of blue.
Yeah.
And I just remember her saying that. And then when I did it, I was like, wow, this does make me feel a little more complete. And so I started painting it. And then I was like, you know what? I'm going to paint what I like to paint. And I just want to laugh. And so I started thinking about things and situations that were funny to me. And I was like, that's what my subject matter is going to be. Because for 2 years, I didn't laugh. And I wasn't happy. And now yeah. I'm going to put that into my paintings.
And two tough years for your children and your husband as well.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm sure they're absolutely thrilled to have the real Angela back.
I hope so.
Yeah. I'm sure they are. Hey, so we've talked about this. Let's see these wonderful paintings.
Oh, gosh. Okay, yeah. Let's see them. All right.
And we'll just let you take the lead and describe what they're about and why you did it. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, this first painting I have is called Standards of Beauty. And this painting was one of the paintings I have that kind of centers more about being a woman. And sometimes when I think about the things that we do for beauty, it can be a little ridiculous. And of course, I wouldn't shave my face yet, but I hear that, you know, at some point a woman may have to do that.
That's a great painting. Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Yes. So that's what that painting was about to me. And I'm actually thinking about turning that into more of a series of just more ridiculous things that we actually do that maybe men don't realize that we do or how awful and painful it is.
Because obviously this, if this were real, would need a lot of Nair.
Oh, gosh, yeah. Yeah, and I don't think I want to do that yet.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, so the next one. This one.
No, those are two of your children?
Yes, those are my two youngest children. And I at the time, I was really debating whether I wanted to, like, go back to work or continue with art. And, you know, it can be a struggle because it's, you know, sometimes it's feast or famine. And just kind of sitting there dreaming, daydreaming. You have these kids hanging on you, and I'm always in constant, like, I need to lose weight mode. Yeah. And you read the diet books, and you know, it's just all about, you know, being a woman and, you know, having these family
obligations. You have four kids. You have an excuse. So you don't look like you need to lose weight, but, you know, there you go. If you did, yeah.
We all are never happy.
Now, let me ask you a question. You, sure. Do you have a photographic memory? I mean, because obviously you and the kids didn't pose for this. So were you looking at pictures of them and yourself? Or?
Yeah, what I do is I'll think of a situation or what I want to paint, and then I usually use my family or, you know, friends as my models because I am telling a joke.
Because you know what they look like pretty much? Or
well, I use photographs. Okay. Like I'll snap a shot of the situation, and my kids are just like real, and my husband are really good models for me.
I'm not sure all kids and husbands would be this cool.
No. I mean, the things I've done to poor Chris, he's really a good sport. So yeah, that's what that painting is about. And
that's a great painting.
Thank you. So
all right, what's next?
The next one. Oh, this is my husband, Chris. This is a watercolor I did of him. This is called Bang. And
It's called Bang.
And it does have a little bit of an innuendo with it because he is holding a banana straight at us.
I thought that was a banana. Yeah.
But yeah, I was kind of playing with the idea of his banana. Poor Chris.
I notice he's not smiling.
He's like James Bond in this one.
Yeah, it kind of looks like a secret agent. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I was going for. He's a secret agent with his banana. So my next one, this is a fan favorite of my lady followers.
That is a bra, right?
Yeah, that is a bra. And this painting is called Best Part of the Day. And if any woman
so taking
knows,
off your bra?
Oh my gosh, yes. Yeah, it's like, yeah. I don't know if I can equate it anything for a man. Like, yeah. I don't know. I often thought, like, if you take your jock strap off, I don't know, something like that. But it's just a breath of fresh air to take your bra off and just fling it across the room.
Well, I grew up in the 60s. I was in college in the 60s, and a lot of women young ladies didn't wear bras.
They were burning them.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Probably not good when they got older. But I keep saying great, but that is so funny, and that really probably connects with women, as you said.
Oh my gosh, yeah, bras stink. Yeah, so that was that.
How long did it take you to do that?
That piece, I think I did that in a day.
Wow.
Yeah.
How long does it usually take you to do a painting?
If I sit, and I usually do it in like 8-hour stints. Like, it could take 2 or 3 days, depending on what medium I'm using. If it's acrylic, and that painting was acrylic.
What medium do you usually use?
I float between acrylic oil and watercolor.
Okay. What's your favorite?
Probably watercolor. That's my thing.
Do you stand when you paint?
Sometimes, a lot of times I don't have a studio. I use my living room, and I'll sit on the couch and I put on some kind of history documentary and I paint to that.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
So you really have a steady hand. You can't have the shakes and paint like this.
Oh, maybe. I don't know. I think I am shaky, and I'm always up and down because when the kids are at school, I still have 2 dogs that have to come in and out of the house.
I think you're making life any more for us.
I didn't mention all the chickens I have. Segues great into this painting.
Yes, you have chickens, and afterwards, but that's you're not. That's you, and you're not. In this, is that supposed to be you?
Yeah, that's.
That's not the most flattering portrait of yourself.
No,
and it's meant obviously to be so.
Yeah, absolutely. I that painting is called Chickens Don't Fly, and for me it's really like a little bit about my fear because I have a lot of this anxiety, and sometimes I address that the situation.
So there's a deeper meaning to your painting.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of times, you know, I'll do something funny, but then sometimes I delve into, especially if I'm struggling at the time with my anxiety or my fear, and that's what this painting was about, just being fearful of doing things, and like chickens really don't fly if you throw them up in the air, which I'm not going to say I've ever done that, but I know they kind of glide and they fall down, and sometimes, I feel a little bit like a chicken.
Well, you're almost kind of like, besides a painter, you're somewhat like a philosopher to a degree, right? There's a context.
I try. I want my paintings not just to be a surface, like, okay, that's pretty or that's funny. I want some of them to be a little more in depth so that, you know, people think. And that's why I try to use comedy.
What did they use in the art world? Would that be, how would you describe that? Now, I used the word philosophy, which is probably the wrong word, but it's symbolic or?
Yeah, the symbolism, the meaning,
Wow, that's powerful.
Thank you.
Can't wait to see some more.
Well, let's see what I have next. Oh, okay. This is a watercolor. This is called Cool With All These Balls. And I got the idea for this painting because, as a mother, I talk to a lot of my mother friends, and we talk about all the responsibilities that we have in life, and you really are like juggling these balls, and it can become overwhelming. But in a way, you're just cool with it, you know, and you have to be, or you're going to drop all the balls. So that's what that painting was about. It's kind of my...
That is really clever.
Yeah, it's my shout-out to all my mom friends and people who have a lot of responsibility in life and have to juggle a lot of balls. But we do it well.
You know, that's why everybody is so appreciative of their mother,
Oh, my gosh, yeah. You don't realize it till you get into that situation in your life where you're doing the things that she was doing. I call my mom all the time, and I'm like, I'm sorry. Especially as my children enter their teenage years and things get a little more difficult. I'm like, I'm sorry, Mom.
You know, it's really interesting. I have two sons who are now parents of themselves, mm-hmm. their own. And it's interesting to see them as parents. And see them with dealing with their children when they were your children at one time.
Yep. Do you kind of feel good because you're like, you're getting what you gave me?
My
mom always used to say that to me. She's like, I hope you have one just like you.
oldest son is a little strong-willed, and he always has been. And so he and I would clash sometimes. Uh-huh. And his oldest son seems to be the same.
What goes around comes
so
around.
I can't wait as he gets older to see that dynamic. That I love the context of that and the story it portrays.
Thank you. I'm gonna move on to the next one.
You tell me, what is this?
This is called Gravity, and it's the subheading is the bigger they are, the harder they fall. And this is all about having breasts and that like eventually gravity catches up.
That's just to go with that idea. and come up with that. That's incredible.
Thank you. But it's just kind of a silly look at being a woman again. And unless you have them, you don't really understand.
Gravity does suck. I hope we can say that on VCTV. But anyway, that's great. Saying that's great, but they are.
Thank you. Yes, gravity does stink. Let me move on to my next one. This is called, and I always butcher it, but my ancestry coming from Berks County is Pennsylvania Dutch, and this painting is called Kunst du Mikkelfunge, which means do you catch flies? And this was actually my very first painting I did seriously when I decided I was going to start painting, and it's just kind of a little story about, husband and wife and that fly, and it's kind of annoying. You can see the annoyed face that I'm making, and he's very determined, and, it could go vice versa, too.
Especially when you guys are having a fun moment there. Yeah. But that's marriage. That's life.
It is. Yeah. It's work, and sometimes we annoy each other. And sometimes it's great.
Exactly. That's what long-term relationships are. And you guys haven't been married as long as a lot of people. But there is an annoyance factor because you know each other too well.
We'll be 15 years next year, I believe. So it's been a journey, but a good one,
Well,
marriage is, and I have a painting that's coming up soon that makes it look like it's not fun, but I am really
appreciative. Let's keep going. I don't know how many because we only have 5 minutes left, and I want to see them all.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, this is called Little Miss Muffet Faces Her Fear, and that's my daughter, and that is obviously about, coming up against something that you're fearful of, and it was another time that I was feeling a little insecure and a little fearful, and
just how you capture that, with that idea, that concept.
And that's my daughter. She's very strong and not fearful, and I admire that in her. So I, in a way, I look up to her. Let's see what we have next. This is called Millennial Gardening, and
I don't even know what millennial gardening is.
A millennial is somebody who is.
I know who they are.
I kind of fall like I'm at the very beginning of it, according to some demographics, and so I'm kind of making fun of myself too. But this is my sister, and she is a full-blown millennial. But aren't we all like where I'm always on a device and I'm not paying attention to what's around me? So in this painting, she's trying to water plants, and she's
I get it. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Your husband is a heck of a sport.
Isn't he, though? This is called Talk Dirty to Me. And this was for a show that was about a muse. And I was just kind of looking at the idea of, in traditional paintings where you see a man paint a woman who's his muse.
Yeah.
It's very, sexual. And for me, I was just like, isn't it great when they clean? Is it like what's more sexy than a man that helps you clean up? So he has his vacuum cleaner and he got a little butt crack.
I wasn't going to bring that up, but I noticed that.
Yeah. Well, that,
And you're scoping him out?
Yeah, right? I'm painting him. Yeah. So, and that's the beauty of Chris. That was his idea to have his butt crack sticking out. So he's a very good
God bless
sport.
Chris. All right, let's keep going. I got 3 minutes left.
This I actually had an ovary removed last summer.
And you found a painting of that.
I promised my gynecologist that I would make a painting about this. But this is called pre-existing condition because at the same time there was like a lot of healthcare reform things coming up, and it was ironic to me that being a woman can actually be a pre-existing condition because of the organs that we have inside our bodies.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, yep, and it's true.
God.
Pregnancy, you know, having a uterus, these are all things that work against you. Okay. This is called Sinner. This is another one of my darker paintings, but I'm crossing my fingers, if you notice, as I'm praying and asking for forgiveness. So it's kind of that idea, like, forgive me, but I don't really mean it kind of thing.
I don't think you have time to sin, but anyway.
Believe me, you all do. And this is the painting I was talking about. This is called Till Death Do Us Part. And it's another look at marriage. Now, I need to make some happier paintings of marriage because it looks like I want to kill Chris all the time.
Yeah, because pretty soon that people will be looking for the divorce.
I know. That'll be my goal. My next painting will be just Chris as an angel or something, because that's what he is.
That's great. How many more do you have? Because we have less than 2 minutes.
I think that was the last one. Yeah, we did it.
Your inspiration. I mean, you know, obviously these are things that people live with when they're married, especially with children, but to come up with that, it's more than just having a gift with your hands. You have a creative mind.
Yeah. I like to tell stories.
You're a storyteller.
I am, yeah. But I'm terrible with words. So for me, to make a painting is the easiest way to do it.
You know, it's funny because we all have different skill sets.
Yeah.
I tell stories too.
Yeah.
And I'm good with words. Mm-hmm. The only thing I paint are bedrooms and homes. You know,
I'm sure you do it well.
And bathrooms, but you know. But my God. But listen, we're out of time, basically, but thank you so much. You have one incredible story. Much success to you.
Thank you.
With your family, with your career, and stay in touch. Angela Faust Izzo, and you have a website?
I do. It's Angela Izzo Artist.
All right, check it out, and so you can buy some of her paintings and go to some of her exhibits. And for now, this is Mike Zielinski saying goodbye.